So that was last weekend, and 25 people got baptized, and that was amazing. And the whole time, and even watching the pictures afterwards, I just think about how much that looks like family. I mean, it just looked like a bunch of family hanging out at a family reunion. And so that's awesome. That's what we're shooting for. That's the whole point, right? We're all one big family, saved under Christ. And so that was amazing. So why don't we pray for this morning's offering? Ushers, if you want to come forward. Father God, we thank you for today, Lord. We thank you for all those that gave of themselves to be baptized into your kingdom, like you set as an example before us, Jesus, when you were baptized by John. And so baptized into carrying out the will of your Father. And so, Father, we thank you for that. We thank you for the gifts you give us, our jobs and our resources and our friends and family. And Father, we give part of our resources back to you this morning, and we pray for the gift. We pray for the giver. And we just pray for the advancement of your kingdom and the growing of your family in our city, in our state, in our nation, our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so Max Lucado said it best, I think. If anybody doesn't understand what baptism is, this one should get it for you. And he's a pretty prophetic guy, pretty well-learned person, Max Lucado. And he broke it down to baptism turns tire kickers into car buyers. And I guess that's essentially what it is. So that's about as simple as we can get it. Coming up this Wednesday, or the Wednesday night classes are starting again. So we have the free meal at 5:15, worship at 6, and then the classes start at 6:15. So I invite you guys all out to that. Also, this coming weekend is Powwow Weekend down at United Tribes. And so if you guys want to come with other people from church here, there's a sign-up sheet out in the gathering place, and you'll be contacted. I'll go out there, just kind of hang out together. Luke Holter is coming next weekend on Sunday, and he's going to talk about the power of the Holy Spirit. So that's a good follow-up to baptism and things like that. Also, September 14th, 9 o'clock, we are doing another outdoor movie night. And if you want to help out, or if you think that sounds kind of cool and you want to just come help us set stuff up, September 11th, we're doing a meeting for that. We're going to be showing Transformers. If you're a child of the 80s, like me, you'll know what Transformers are all about. If not, Kurt's got a clip coming up in a little bit. The last chance to do paintball is coming up. We're doing a paintball outing to the Three Brothers Field. That's Sunday, September 16th from 2 to 6. Meet here at 1:15 to drive out there. And that's going to be a lot of fun. ELI starting up again for the fall. We have a new class starting. The class is going to be called Leading and Building Teams in the 21st Century Church. We couldn't think of a good acronym for that, because it's like lab to get. And so you're stuck with a long title. And if you're interested in learning more about leadership skills, building your leadership skills, those are awesome time. It's a whole session on those. It'll be Thursday nights. Pursuit, Prayer, and Worship is coming up again on September 22nd. If you enjoy worship, Jackie does a really good job for worship. But there's a lot of other people that do a really good job for worship, and there's a whole night of worship. So if you want to come to that, that's coming up on the 22nd. The youth are doing their fall retreat again. Last year we went to Badlands Ministries outside of Medora, and it was an awesome time. It's a retreat intended to get students to get deeper into their spirituality, and there's a lot of time spent on their own and reading and studying scripture and things like that. So it's not all fun, but there's some fun stuff. So I encourage you, if you have kids, to get them signed up for that. If you want to sponsor kids, I don't even know if there's a fee for this one this year, but we'll have more info on that later. Krista in the kids care is looking for some help. If you enjoy little kids, and they're pretty little kids, it's all preschool, and you want to make some part-time income, that's a good way to do it. I do it, and it's a lot of fun. And they are pretty crazy, some of those kids. So today, Kurt's starting a new series. It's called Transformed, Be Transformed, and hence the Transformers. It'll be awesome. And if you need any information about anything going on at the church, you can check out the website at newsongbismarck.com. And with that, here's Kurt.
Thanks, Josh. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Song. We're glad you're here with us to celebrate the goodness of God together on this Labor Day weekend. I was surprised that people showed up. So nice out. My wife, she was pretty iffy this morning, whether she was going to come or not. But she did come, so I'm glad she did. And everybody else, for that matter. This last week, hopefully we had a good week. I had an interesting week because I got this sinus. I don't know if it's allergies or if it's cold or what. So that's been interesting. But then also, I had a week without my phone because I dropped it in the pool. We have an above-ground pool I was draining, and I didn't know that it dropped off my hip and fell, and then water as I was dumping it gushed and just, and I didn't realize till later. So it didn't work all week, and it was bittersweet. And I'm back up and running. So anyway, I'm glad you guys are again here this morning on this beautiful day and beautiful Labor Day weekend. And with it being Labor Day weekend and with school now about 7 days in here, a lot of churches and organizations at this time of year, they take a minute and they do a prayer for this education system. And so I wrote a prayer here, a kind of a proclamation that I want us to all read together. But before I show you that, I want to show you what parents do on the first day of school. Go ahead and let's put that first slide up. I'm kidding. We don't do that with them standing there. Anyway. Okay, so let's go to the prayer proclamation here. So I just want you guys to say this with me out loud. This is just a little prayer and a proclamation to God for this coming school year. As we've, over the last years, we've had in our school systems, you know, shootings and whatnot. We just want to pray that God will, even though, you know, God, there's Christians in schools and there's Christian teachers. We know that, you know, they don't, for whatever reason, we can't pray publicly in schools yet. Maybe someday we'll get to do that again. Of course, when Jesus comes back, we'll get to. But anyway, this is something we can pray for our school. So let's just read this together. Also, sorry for my voice. It's all raspy because of this cold thing. So forgive me and bear with me. Here we go. It says, Heavenly Father, we come to you as another school year has begun, thanking you for our education system and praying for provision and protection for every student and teacher. We lift up each student and ask that they would connect with their God-given gifts and talents so they can be all that you have created them to be. We pray that you will reveal to them solutions to problems, cures for diseases, and ways to bridge gaps so we can live in harmony with you and each other. Let's go to the next slide here. We also lift up each teacher, asking for your compassion and patience as they encounter challenges, and for your joy and delight as they celebrate each accomplishment. This 2012 Labor Day weekend, we proclaim you as our great teacher, and we, all your students, thankful for the ability to learn your timeless and limitless truths. We pray this in the matchless name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Okay, well, that's kind of to get us going here. Also, I wrote on the top of my page here, so before I forget, if you want to go to the paintball outing, this is our second annual, you can sign up at the information booth and get more information on that. Okay, anyway, so this transformation we're going to start this morning. I'm really excited to start this series, mostly because we just got done with the hell series. And if you've ever studied and prepared to speak on hell, it's not enjoyable. You kind of get soaked in it, and it's just intellectually, emotionally, just not a very enjoyable way to live for 3 months of your life as you prepare for something like that. And anybody that's ever taught on the subject and spoke, or if you study on it, you know what I mean. And so I'm glad to be going to transformation, which is number one on your outline. Transformation. You should have an outline in your bulletin there you can grab. And we're going to start this series kind of broad, like a funnel, and we'll kind of get more narrow as we unfold the series here. But there's a definition there on your outline. It says, an act, process, or an instance of transforming or being transformed. So an act or process. So this is a process or an instant, something that happens fast. And then these next two, 2A and 2B, I love, not because I'm into science but so much, but it says genetic modification of a bacterium by incorporation of free DNA from another ruptured bacterial cell. So if you like science, then you really like that one. And then this one is, the next one, genetic modification of a cell by the uptake and incorporation of exogenous DNA. And the reason I love that so much is because that's how God transforms us. He starts on the inside and he works out. It starts on the inside out at the DNA level. And that's something that at this, the fall of man, when sin came into the planet, and this bacterial, matter of fact, if you study science, there was an article that was done a couple years ago, but there was a science, I can't remember what college it was. I should have did my research on this. But anyway, there was a college that did a research on bacteria. And everything in the sky, the land, and the sea that they have tested for bacteria, there's a bacteria in everything. And some theologian scientists believe that bacteria is actually what came into the planet at the fall of man, bacteria, this degradation of everything in the planet. And so anyway, the reason I love that is Jesus is working from the inside out in this process. Sometimes it's instantaneous, sometimes it's a slow process to make us more like Christ, the prototype. Jesus is the prototype. He is the first fruit, the Bible calls it. He is what we are being transformed in. When we think about what are we being transformed in, we know what we are being transformed in as Christians, because Jesus, on this earth, when God sent his Son, everything that God had to say, everything that God thinks, everything God feels was in the man, Jesus Christ. It was portrayed to the planet. He is the prototype. He was tested, he was approved, and he was commissioned. Just like, guess what? That's what's going to happen to us. We're going to be tested, we're going to be approved, and we're going to be commissioned all the days of our life, and then we die. And so if you're here this morning, you go, I'm kind of getting sick of that process. But you're not dead yet, so get used to it. We have more coming. But we're going to talk more about that in a second. So anyway, transformation. If we look at the scripture here, under number 1, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, it says, now the Spirit, or the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed. So you can circle that word, transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So you can circle that word. And then the Greek word there for transformed, which is, we'll all recognize as we look at it, it's pronounced metamorpho, and this word is where we get our word, our English word, metamorphosis. And metamorphosis, I don't know about you, but metamorphosis, when I think of that word metamorphosis, I think of a butterfly. So I got a slide here of a butterfly, and the process it goes through, it starts with this egg, goes into a larva or a caterpillar, then it goes into the pupa, the chrysalis, and then the adult butterfly, and it's cute, and it's nice, and it's, you guys have all seen butterflies, how they flutter, and they just land so graciously and gently and cute and nice and fine. And if you've had that type of transformation in your life, I'm jealous. Because the type of transformation that I've had in my life wasn't cute and cuddly. It was rough and tough, kind of like Optimus Prime from Transformers. Take a look at this video clip. Megatron at the top of the building there, he's going to go kick his butt, but that's Megatron, he's going to, Morpheus, that's another show, Optimus Prime, that's kind of how my life went through. I went through a real violent transformation, and so whatever the case, whether you've had the nice butterfly transformation or the rough transformation like Optimus Prime, the reality is we all are, that's God's intention. He wants to transform us, to break us out of this numbness so that we can be all that he has called and created us to be. And so as we go forward here, we look at number 2 on your outline. How does this happen? At least 2 ways transformation takes place. And these 2 are what we're going to talk about over the weeks to come and really are important, is personal and corporate transformation. Personal and corporate transformation. So that starts individually with us, ourselves individually, and then corporately, working together as a family unit, as a neighborhood, as a church body, as a city, as a state, as a nation, and so on. So there's a personal and a corporate transformation that God wants to take place. The number 3 on your outline there is, who are we? So we're going to look at who, what, where, why, how, and sometimes why. All right, what, where, what, who, what, where, when, how, and sometimes why.
English teachers, help me. Okay, so anyway, we're going to look at these starting with number three in your outline. Who are we? Who are we according to God's perception of us and as the Creator? What did He create us to be? And number three is ambassadors. We're ambassadors. 2 Corinthians chapter 5:20 says, "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors." So you can circle that word, ambassadors, as though God were making His appeal through us. You see how huge that is? As though God were making His appeal through us. And what's the appeal? We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God has entrusted us with this message, personally and corporately. He has said, "My son, this great thing that has happened to the planet, the good news of the gospel, that Jesus has come, He has blotted out our transgressions. We can be free. We can walk forward in our lives with full confidence." This is what we get to invite people to. It's an incredible opportunity and a privilege and a stewardship that God is saying, "I have entrusted you as my children, as my people, as ambassadors to do this." Which means it takes two things for us to do this. Is to hear God. That's why we're all here this morning. We're like, okay, what does the Bible say about this life that we're living? So I don't get stuck and get distracted from the way I'm supposed to be living and the way I've been created to living. There's two things. There's one, God wants to be intimately involved in our life. He wants to be involved. He wants to be invited into our life. He's a perfect gentleman. He's not going to force Himself into our world. But we can invite Him, and He'll come into any situation that He's invited into. And so when we invite Him in, He will speak to us. But we have to listen. And then once we hear, then we speak. Luke Holter is going to be coming here next weekend. And if you've been here when Luke is here, Luke is awesome. I've got to walk him through his own transformation. He died on a hospital bed in an emergency room. His heart was cauterized 7 times. He should not be living. But God's not done with him. He had his own Optimus Prime transformation. And he is radically changed. And he operates in the prophetic that is just exciting and incredible. And last time he was here, don't get scared now, but he invited a couple of people to come up here during service, and he prophesied over them, and that was about a year ago, and exactly what he said has come to pass in these people's lives. But he's very sensitive, so he won't be sensitive to us, North Dakotans, right? We don't want to be brought up in front of anybody, and he's sensitive to that. So if you're like, "I don't want to get brought up in front of nobody," he knows if you do or don't, and he won't call you up. But anyway, he's an incredible dude, And I want to show you a short video clip so you can see his heart. But y'all could, in relation to this message, we need to listen and then speak. Go ahead and let's show this.
I was in my office the other day, and I watched this video of this young girl. She couldn't have been any older than 5. And she was born deaf, and her parents were taking her to this doctor's office so she could get these special hearing aids and so she could be able to hear for the first time. And the father looked at the camera, and his eyes began to well up with tears, and he said, "I've always wanted her to know that I thought she was beautiful and that I love her. I've always wanted her to hear those words," he said. You could see the string of videos as they played on and how they were getting more frustrated because they weren't finding a fix for this issue. And in the final video, in the final doctor's visit, the doctor had tried out a new type of hearing aid implant. And the doctor said, "Okay, we're going to turn it on now. She should be able to hear you for the first time." The doctor turned it on. The little girl's eyes lit up. Her whole face brightened up, and she turned and looked at her father, and he looked at her with tears rolling down his cheeks, and he said, "I love you, and you're beautiful." And I sat in my office at this moment, and I started to cry, and I began to ask the Holy Spirit, "How can we hear?" Because most of us are born into this world just like that little girl, completely unable to hear the Father's voice. There's people walking around right now completely deaf, not knowing that the Father loves them and that He thinks they're beautiful. But God has given us an awesome gift called prophecy. And with prophecy, we can bestow identity and destiny on people's lives. We can give people back their dignity. So my question to you is, will you listen? Will you speak?
So yeah, Luke will be here next week, and it's going to be awesome. So I come early if you're going to. And oh, by the way, we have kids ministry at the first service now. So if, and they're packed at this service. So if you can come at the 9 o'clock service, we would appreciate that, especially if you have children. But Luke's going to be here next weekend, and it's going to be powerful. But will we listen and will we speak? And this is God's challenge to us. We have this message that we get to bring to the world. We can be reconciled to God through Jesus Christ, which leads us to number four here. What are we? So we got who are we? We're ambassadors. And how are we supposed to do this? What are we? What does the Bible call us is in relation to ambassadors? In Mark chapter 9, there's a word there that's used, salt. So number four, the blank is salt. Mark chapter 4, it says, "For everyone will be seasoned with fire, and every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. Salt is good, but if that salt loses its flavor, how will it be seasoned again? Have salt in yourselves, and have peace with one another." This scripture, and there's a handful of other scriptures that deal with salt. And these scriptures can be really misunderstood if we don't understand what Jesus is getting at. Because you could look at this scripture and say, well, if salt loses its flavor, how will it be re-seasoned again? And there's a scripture that says that salt loses its flavor, it's no good except to be thrown out and to be trampled. And it can sound like hopelessness. If my salt loses its flavor, how am I going to get flavor again? Hopelessness. Because, do you guys know that salt has no shelf life? Salt cannot lose its flavor. There's only one way that salt can lose its flavor. And this is what Jesus is getting at. Jesus is full of hope. We all know that, right? There's never a situation that's hopeless to God. Never. Salt can't lose its flavor. There's only one way that salt loses its flavor, and that's by being spent. If you take some salt and you put it on the shelf in your pantry, it'll never lose its flavor. You can take it out a year, 5 years, 10 years later, and it'll still have the flavor of salt in those crystals. Until you spend that salt, you put it on the steak or whatever you're putting it on, and it absorbs in and evaporates and absorbs and seasons that food, that's the only way that salt can lose its flavor. The only way. So what is Jesus getting at here? Is he saying, make sure you don't spend yourself, leave yourself on the shelf, so that you'll never lose your flavor, but then go season things? So what is it, Jesus? We're supposed to keep our flavor on the shelf, or are we supposed to go spend ourselves and lose our flavor? What is it? Is Jesus confused? Of course not. He's wondering, number one, are you listening? And then number two, he wants to show us something. In these scriptures, when it talks about the fire represents what? The Holy Spirit. The fire represents the Holy Spirit. The salt, the Bible in that scripture says, when we give ourselves as a sacrifice, the salt, we are to salt it. How many of you guys know what a salt lick is? I was going to show you a picture of a cow. He was taking a lick of a salt lick, and the tongue was like a foot long, you know. It was just really gross. Then I thought, I'm not going to show that. I could just paint the picture for you. But anyway, a salt lick, I mean, if you have a steak, and you go grab a salt lick and stick it on your steak, is that going to be enjoyable? No. It'd be disgusting, especially if a cow licked it. Get off the cow subject, Kurt. Okay. Or it's a steak or whatever you're seasoning. If you have no salt, it's not as good. So the point is to season it properly. And so when we season when the Spirit of God lives in us and we pour ourselves out to season things, other people, situations, to bring peace to situations, what happens? This is what happens. And this is the danger about the salt that can lose its flavorness and then be worthless and not have any purpose anymore, is when you and I spend ourselves, and we're going to, whether you like it or not. How many have ever been burnt out and tired? Okay, North Dakotans, are you awake? How many have been burnt out and tired? Raise your hands. I know you all have. And if you haven't, call me and I'll put you to work. We all are going to be spent. So Jesus' plan isn't to not be spent, not be tired, not be burnt out. That's not his plan. His plan is when you get there and you are spent and burnt out, don't stay there. Because if you get burnt out and spent and you start to get frustrated, you're going to say, I'm not going to do that again because that was too hard. That's not his plan, because then you're worthless. You're going to get just trampled by the world and by all the cares of this world. You're going to make no worldly impact. What he's saying with the fire is, in Luke 11, he says, anybody who asks, my Father will give them the Holy Spirit. So when we get to that point of being empty, it's real simple. God, I don't want to go on. I don't want to have to deal with this. I don't want to have to do with that. It's okay to vent, but then to say, God, I know that I'm still breathing, so you've got a plan. Will you fill me with your Spirit, to overflowing? If we could take salt and put it on the shelf, and if we could literally have salt lose its flavor but still be in crystalline form, sitting on the shelf, there's no humanly way possible for that salt to be able to be reflavored again, except through God coming down and miraculously doing something and making it have flavor again. Only he can do that. And the point is in us, it's the same way. When we get burnt and spent, we have to ask ourselves, are we going to continue or are we going to bail? And if you're going to continue, you need to ask and invite the Holy Spirit in on a regular basis so that we have the motivation and the strength to go through life. So I encourage you, let it be part of your mantra. Holy Spirit, fill me. Even if you're like, I feel pretty good and I'm energized. I really don't need the Holy Spirit today. Wrong answer. You ask him. Get into the habit of asking, God, will you just come into this situation? Just invite him in and he will do just that. And so as we go through this process of transformation, inviting him into it as an ambassador of this whole salt idea so that we can make a difference on this planet is his plan. Not like a salt lick. We're not absent, but in proper context. Okay, let's go on to number 5 here. How are we to do this? Together we grow to care for others. So it starts out personally, and then we join together to care for others strategically. In Matthew chapter 13, it says, he told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, so you can circle the word grows there, yet when it grows, it is the largest of the garden plants and becomes a tree so that the birds can come and perch in its branches. One of the verses here, that again, depending on how long you've been a Christian, how long you've been around Christianese and Christian Bible verses and teaching and so on and so forth, this scripture here can be used wrong, so to speak. For instance, you maybe have said this before. If I just have faith as a mustard seed, we can move mountains. And that's not what it's saying. It's saying faith starts as a mustard seed, and your little bit of faith will move little bit of things. But your faith has to grow if you're going to overcome bigger challenges. If we're going to overcome citywide issues and statewide issues and national issues, it's not going to be because me by myself are praying in my closet. Now, don't get me wrong. I would never say don't pray in your closet. You want to do that personally. But when it comes to corporate gathering and saying, the scripture is very clear on this, we can do more together than we do alone. Not to invalidate being alone. That's great. Be alone and be praying and so on. But to corporately work together to make an impact, we can do more together if we are strategic about it. And if we say, you know what, how are we supposed to do this, God? I'll listen. Give us your vision. Give us your plan. One of the things that we're going to be doing in October, and as this series unfolds, we're going to start casting vision about where the Lord is leading us over the next 3 to 5, 10 years even. But one of the things that I want to just talk to you for a minute about is in October, we have a group coming in called Free International. And they deal with the slave trade. And in our state, we've had this slave trafficking happen right in our backyard here now. A couple of weeks ago, there was a young individual, he was about 25 years old, got busted for trafficking people, slavery. and got 45 years in prison right here in North Dakota. It's unbelievable. And it's just sick that this is happening. But what do we do about it? Yes, individually pray. But is there something strategically we can do as a group if we work together? Then there is. And this guy who's going to, in this video, his name is Michael Bartel, the guy in the video, he's going to be coming here in October 13th and 14th. And this is what it's a global ministry called Free International. You can go to freeinternational.org if you want and check it out. But they are looking for churches in the state of North Dakota that could take these people who are being trafficked, that are getting set free, and invite them into their congregation. And have a family congregation wrap their arms around them and say, we will help you get back to a thriving, normal, they don't know what normal is, life. But it's going to take a family like this to say, we'll do it. How are we going to do this? It's going to take strategy. He's going to come and he's going to give us pointers. And we're going to begin this process of what could we really do? How could we really fund this? How could we relationally do this? How could we getting employment for these people? And how for education and all this stuff? How can we do this corporately? But if your faith is as a mustard seed and we don't ever grow it, we'll never do these things. So the strategy is up to us. And we're going to bring this guy in. So take a look at this video, and we'll go on here.
Hi, Mike. It's I'm calling you because I think I've told you I'm a school counselor, and I actually just spoke to a seventh grade student who was recently arrested for prostitution. And in talking to her, she said that she'd be willing to get any kind of help that was available to her. So I was just wondering what you guys had to offer. I'm going to give you my work number and my home.
Believe that we could do something? Okay, I'm going to be honest with you. It scares me, that stuff. And the stuff that the Lord is opening up for us in opportunities scares me. That's why I know it's God. Because if we can do it without Him, we don't need Him to do the stuff He's calling us to do. What's the point? He is going to give us this opportunity, and it scares me. And if you're scared too, if you think about that, like what would that mean for us as a family? And I mean, how and our children? And da da da. I'm with you. I feel the same way. Now, if it really scares you enough, and you don't want to come to New Song anymore, I'd be sad. But I don't blame you. And we will miss you. But I challenge you. I challenge you to get locked in. Let's do something like this. This is one of the things that God is giving us as an opportunity for. And every one of us in our hearts, God is speaking to us about stuff. And we as a congregation, we want to get strategic. We want to say, what are the visions and what is the seeds that the Lord has planted in our hearts that needs to grow? How can we nurture that? And I'm serious, we invite you to call us. The church office and give us your idea and see if there's a way we can make it happen. And we'll do our best if we really believe it's the Lord corporately at New Song that we're supposed to nurture whatever it is. We will do our best to come alongside you financially, relationally, educationally, whatever, so that we can fulfill this thing that the Lord has called for us to do as His ambassadors. So together to care for others. Which leads us to number 6 on your outline. When are we? Or when is the time to get involved? Number 6 is now. There's a large portion of scripture here I want to read. And this is out of the Message translation. So it may not be, you may not be used to this or familiar with the contemporary language here. But I love it because it is such a good communication of what God is saying to us. In 2 Peter chapter 1, it says, Everything that goes into a life of pleasing God has been miraculously given to us by getting to know personally and intimately the one who invited us to God. The best invitation we ever received. We were also given absolutely terrific promises to pass on to you. Your tickets to participation in the life of God after you turned your back on a world corrupted by lust. So don't lose a minute in building on what you've been given. Complementing your basic faith with good character, spiritual understanding, alert discipline, passionate patience, reverent wonder, warm friendliness, and generous love, each dimension fitting into and developing the others. With these qualities active and growing in your lives, no grass will grow under your feet. No day will pass without its reward as you mature in your experience of our Master Jesus. Without these qualities, you can't see what's right before you, oblivious that your old sinful life has been wiped off the books. So friends, confirm God's invitation to you, his choice of you. Don't put it off. Do it now. So circle there, now. Do this, and you'll have your life on a firm footing, the streets paved and the way wide open into the eternal kingdom of our Master and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is one of my life verses. Verse 10 and 11, where it says, in the New King James, it says, make your calling and election sure and you will never stumble. I know people that come into my office and they cycle in life. And they cycle like the rest of us. But the cycle that they have is not the cycle of getting tired and burned out because they're pouring their life out for what God has called and created them to be. They're pouring their life into things and out to things like alcohol and drugs. And they come into my office and they're burnt out and they're like, man, I gotta get off this, I gotta quit drinking and doing drugs and da 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 da. And I'm like, yeah, that's a good idea. Didn't even need me to tell you that. But the reality is this: we are going to spend ourselves on something. One of them brings a reward. Thank you, whoever said that, that's right. Amen, sister. That we're gonna spend ourselves on something. But the question is what is the reward for that spend? We're going to be tired at times. We're going to be burnt out. We're going to be confused. We're going to be shocked. But we might as well do it for the kingdom with eternal purposes that we get to celebrate for all of eternity. And that starts personally, and then it grows corporately. And the Lord is giving us some cool opportunities for us to step into as the days unfold. There's an old saying. When's the best time to plant an oak tree? 25 years ago or today? There's another saying. If you want to end well, you can't think you're going to start doing well at the end and end well. Now, if you're still breathing, it's not the end. So we can start now and the end. No matter whatever you consider your age, whatever you consider, if you're old, you consider yourself old. If you're breathing, you're not old. God is not done with us if you're still alive. And so he wants to come in and do something in our lives, personally and corporately, so that we can make a difference. And for all eternity, we can celebrate that. So let's recap up to this point. We've got transformation or metamorphosis. We've got nice and cute transformation. We've got rough and tough transformation. We've got personal and corporate transformation. We are ambassadors to be salt in growing measure. And when do we start now? Which leads us to number 7 on your outline. And ushers, if you want to come forward and start passing communion this morning, you can start doing that. Number 7 on your outline is where do we start? Where are we at? Starting at home. Starting at home. Joshua 24 says, but as for me and my household, so you can circle household, for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Now, sometimes when we think about our house, our personal home, we maybe think that it's not good enough or it's not ready or it's not clean enough or it's not whatever enough. But the reality is it doesn't matter what your home looks like. Take a look at this picture here I want to show you. My room, what I see, what my mom sees, and what she describes. College students, welcome back to school if you're here.
one of the campuses in town, and I hope your room looks like one of the top two, not the bottom two, but regardless of what your home looks like, it doesn't matter. God wants to start in our home personally, and then our relationships, our family, and then out from there, grow and to make this difference starting at home, whatever your house looks like. And when it comes to this corporate idea that the New Testament church in the first century that came on the scene in cities like Corinth and Ephesus, that took these cities, these world-class cities of their time, and turned them upside down, it wasn't because of technology, it wasn't because they were the coolest, hottest, funnest, smartest, whatever. It was because a home that is full of God and another home that's full of God comes together, and another home that's full of God, another home, another home, another home, until this family, this thing called the church, comes together, and they turn the world upside down and make an impact. That's what transformation looks like corporately. It starts in our home, which takes us to finally number 8 on your outline. Why are we to do this? 2 Corinthians chapter 3 says, He has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. So you can circle two words there. One is life, and the other is ministers. He's called us to be ambassadors, to be ministers, wherever we're at. If you are a CEO, if you are an employee, if you are a student, if you're a pastor, whatever it is that you are, He is saying to us, you are ministers. Wherever you go, starting at home, to bring life. And how do we do that? When we fail, we repent and we apologize and we make it right to the best of our ability. And then, of course, we grow and say, you know what? Things that are destroying my life, things that are cyclical, that are not healthy for me, I've got to quit doing them. I've got to allow my faith to grow and overtake me in these areas so that they are overshadowed, so that I'm not burnt out for things that are worthless, but I'm spent for things that have an eternal reward. That is God's plan. That's His promise. And one of the things that, if we don't understand about this, is if we feel like, you know, that room picture, well, my room's not clean enough yet. My life's not clean enough. I can't be an ambassador yet. I'm not good enough yet. If you're waiting to get good enough, I just got to read more Bible verses, and I just got to study more Bible verses, and I just got to have my theology better. There's only one person who has his theology 100% correct, and that's Jesus. That's it. So it's not about, if you're waiting to become perfect, you'll never do anything. He takes us where we're at. He takes us just where we're at, and He grows us up, and He gets us being used wherever it is for His glory, in our starting in our home, in our place of work, and then corporately for a kid who's been trafficked. I believe that in 5 years from now, 10 years from now, this would be the vision that I would see us as a church happen. That there would be some person that we would have that coming out of the trafficking that would be set free, that would come here, that we would embrace and love, and we would get them an education, we'd get them finances, we'd get them employment, we'd get them into good relationships, and they would stand right here someday and share the testimony of what we did to make a change in their life. That's where we want to head. If you want to be part of that, stick around. If not, stick around anyway. Okay. And why, again, is to bring life. To bring life. This week I had a friend of mine who, I just was at home and not doing anything, and I just thought of him. He just popped into my head. And so I sent him a text. I said, hey, how you doing? Thinking about you. And I actually had just prayed for him, just a breath prayer. You know, it's like, God, I just, whatever he's going through, you know, and I know him. I know that he's in a hard time right now. But at this moment, whatever he's going through, he could be sleeping for all I know. I just pray that you would just give him provision and protection. Those are my two things I usually pray for people, provision and protection. And I sent him that text. And he texted me back right away. And he said, you have no idea what just happened. And I'm like, what? I was praying, saying, God, will you just show me a sign that you're thinking about me, that you care for me? And your text came. He goes, Kurt, my room, I have never felt the presence of God like I'm feeling right now.
That's the tangible presence of God that he wants to work in us and through us. Following those little nudges of sending a text to somebody, sending an email, making a phone call, we don't want to discredit those because they can be very life to the people on the other end. And if you've ever been on the receiving end of that, you know exactly what that feels like. So how do we start this? How do we begin this process? If you're here this morning and you say, you know, I believe in God, but I don't know how to go forward with God. What is the steps? Here's some simple starting points. And I changed this verse. We usually read this verse every week, but I added a couple of verses to it in Romans 10:9. It says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As the scripture says, and this is the huge part, it just means some people, or a few people, or maybe one, no, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. That's what he wants us to do, is put our trust in him, invite him into this situation. And also, if you're here this morning, you say, you know, I don't know how to pray, I've never prayed. There's an old song, I don't know if you guys remember this, there's an old song that Connie Lundstrom wrote when I was probably like 7 years old. It was an old song of this little girl who went to their house, and she was eating at their house for dinner. And they said, okay, it's time to pray. And they looked at this little girl, and they said, why don't you pray to bless the meal? And she said, and then the song goes, I'm sorry, I don't know how to pray. My mommy never taught me, so I don't know what to say. Please forgive me. I'm sorry, I don't know how to pray. So if you're here this morning, and you're like, you know, I never got taught how to pray, here's a launching pad for you, real simple. Father God, I am sorry for sinning against you, and I ask that you forgive my sins because of what Jesus did for me. I receive him as my Savior. Help me strengthen my spiritual discipline so that I can be all that you created me to be. In the matchless name of Jesus, I ask. Amen. So we're going to take communion this morning, but I didn't get any. I'll be nicer. Can I have some? Thanks, Josh. And so we're going to do communion this morning, and as everybody's got their communion. We've got the bread and the cup. And the bread, if we look at this scripture, I wanted to kind of focus on this morning. The scripture, before we look at the scripture, though, I got to put up this slide for you. Read this with me. Ready? Read this with me. What if you woke up today with only the things you thank God for yesterday? What if you woke up today with only the things you thank God for yesterday? You know, the Bible says when we die, it calls it falling asleep. When we fall asleep for the last time on this planet and we wake up in front of our Maker, were we thankful for the Son of the living God? Because how we respond to Jesus is what makes eternity possible. So with the bread this morning, as we look at this verse, the last verse on your outline there, it says, is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf. We who are many are one body. We all share the one loaf. So if we think about this little piece of bread that you're holding, this little crumb piece, this was cut out of a loaf, out of a pan, and split up for all of us. And we could, if we took the time, I suppose, pick all the pieces back and put it all together and make it all fit in the pan again. But God is saying, that piece that you're holding there in your hand comes from a single loaf. And that single loaf, even though literally is a pan of bread, it represents Christ, the prototype, the beginning. And as we take this bread and identify with Christ, we recognize we are just a part of the loaf. We are a part of the bigger picture. Personally, I take this bread, we take this bread, but corporately, as we take together, God has commissioned us. He is testing us. He is approving us. And he is commissioning us to make an impact personally and corporately for his kingdom. Let's take the bread together. And the juice represents his blood that was poured out for us for the remission of our sins or for the covering of our sins. Transubstantiation is the long word. Basically, it means somebody, we're guilty, every one of us. If we look in the mirror, we know we've all sinned. The Bible says you broke one part of the law, you broke it all. Somebody's got to pay for that sin. If you've seen the movie Courageous, if you haven't seen it, I encourage you to rent it. But if you've seen the movie Courageous, it talks about the judge. A guilty person comes in front of a judge. Does the judge, does he judge that person by what the good things they've done in their life or the thing that they got busted for? Judges according to what we did wrong, not what we did right. And God is God and the judge, and he is saying, who is going to pay for your sins? I offered my son to the planet to cover their sins, corporately and individually. Are you going to receive it unto yourself? Are you going to allow my son, what he did for you, to cover your sin? Let's take the cup together. God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that we don't have to pay for our own sins, but we can grow in what you did and what you started on the cross. That we get to identify with your life, your sacrifice. God, I pray that for all of us here, that if there's anybody here that says, I've never begun a relationship with Jesus, and if you're here this morning and that's you, it starts out real simple. That's that seed of like a mustard seed. It's real simple. It's Y-E-S, three letters. Yes, Jesus, I receive salvation. I receive Jesus to cover my sins. Forgive me for my sins. Help me to have disciplines that I need to grow to become the person that you want me to be, that you've created me to be. Give us your vision. Give us your passion. Give us the holy discontent for the things that are on this earth that are not right that you want us to step into. I thank you that we can trust you with it all. Thank you for never giving up on us. God, we love you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, if you're here this morning, and you, let's all stand together. If you're here this morning and you're a visitor, you'd like more information about New Song, we have a visitor packet at the information booth with a gift in it. If you're here this morning and you're putting your faith in Christ for the first time, we have a packet for you and a Bible for you and a gift for you too. Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great Labor Day weekend.